Thank you. two worship services. The first one started at 9 a.m. this morning, and it was a memorial service remembering 9/11. The second one was a dedication service. In that service, thanked David Hayworth for the generous donation that he gave us
that was put towards the renovation for this chapel.
And during that time, in this space, I could just feel myself getting really happy, just happy to be here. I could feel my heart growing in this space. And all the while, I was thinking back to those times when I would come in church, and sometimes this still happens, and ask myself, what in the world am I doing here? What brought me here? Why are we doing what we're doing together? And it got me thinking about you guys and that desire that we have in ourselves that brings us here week after week. From wherever we're coming from, our dorms across campus, if you're here for Chapel for Credit, there's something in us that wants to be here together, that wants to worship God together. So I want to give you an image to think about during tonight's service. And I hope that stays with you, not just tonight, but every time you come into a place of worship. So I want you to zoom out, outside of this room. And once you get outside of this room, I want you to grab onto the roof and take off. And I want you to notice the walls around you. Push those down. What's going to be up above you after that? You can answer. Sky. You are going to be under the heavens in the presence of God together. That is what we do when we come in and out of these spaces. There's something in us that brings us to these spaces so we can be in the presence of God together and worship God together. So whenever things are like way too close and you can't really see what's going on, even in beautiful spaces like this, all you have to do is zoom out. So let's breathe into that space tonight. So go ahead and relax into your chairs. And feel the rest come upon you. And let's take one deep breath in right here. Breathe in. And out. Breathing in and out. Last one. Breathing in. For more rest. And breathing out. Breathe in. God, we thank you. We thank you. Even for the needs that are deep inside of us. The ones that we can't quite articulate yet. The ones that are pressing in our mind right now. We thank you for being in those spaces. Thank you for tonight. May we be blessed by this service as we go a little bit deeper inside out into the emotion of anger. Let us see you tonight, even in each other. These things we ask in your name. Thank you.
before, and at least with all of my choirs, they've been coming in rather tired and bags under their eyes and stressed. And so I thought I'd read the second verse before we sing it tonight. It says, "Fear not, I am with thee. O be not dismayed, for I am thy God and will still give thee aid. I will strengthen and help thee and cause thee to stand upheld by my righteous, omnipotent hand." I invite you to stand and join in singing this hymn.
Thank you. pew pocket in front of you, and we invite you to write anything on there that's on your heart or your mind and put it in the offering plate. And then the Board of Stewards, we pray over these every Monday at our weekly meeting. And we really take these seriously. We want to know what's on your heart and mind, so let us know if you feel moved. Our offering this semester is going towards the Salvation Army. Every year we help out with the Angel Tree program, which provides Christmas presents, clothes, and school supplies for kids in the high-growth community that might not otherwise have anything to open up on Christmas morning. So if you feel moved to give, we would really love your help with that. We were able to, you know, make so many Christmas mornings last year, and we're really hoping to exceed our goals and do that again this season. And finally, if you're looking to lead with our faith community right here at HPU, the Board of Stewards is in the process of recruiting some beautiful new faces to lead alongside us. So there is a Google form out if you feel moved and want to lead with us. We invite you to fill that out. And if you have any questions, you can ask me or anyone of the Board of Stewards. Thanks be to God.
In the insert in your bulletin is the text for the anthem that we're going to sing. You may recognize, you may not, you may recognize the tune. This comes from Holst, The Planets, and you'll recognize the melody right off. But the words are so beautiful, I wanted you to be able to follow along as the choir sings.
Thank you. Good evening, church. So will you please stand with me during this prayer as we offer our blessing over this space. We'll start us off in one voice, and then when you see the words appear on the screen, please join in. So may God give us a blessing to this house. May God bless this house from roof to floor, from wall to wall. From wall to wall,
from end to end, from its foundation and in its priority.
In the strong name of the triune God, let all disturbances cease, let captive spirits free, and allow God's Spirit alone dwell within these walls.
We call upon the sacred tree to save, shield, and surround this house, this home, this day, this night, and every night.
May all be welcomed here, friend and stranger, from near and far. May each be blessed and honored as they enter. There is a friend's love in the gentle heart of the Savior. For love of him, we offer friendship and welcome every guest. And as we continue in prayer, will you please join me in saying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
Whoever is slow to anger has great understanding, but one who has a hasty temper exalts folly. A tranquil mind gives life to the flesh, but passion makes the bones rot. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Those who are hot-tempered stir up strife, but those who are slow to anger calm contention. One who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and one whose temper is controlled than one who captures a city. Those with good sense are slow to anger, and it is their glory to overlook an offense. A violent-tempered person will pay the penalty. If you affect an issue, you will only have to do it again. Do not testify against your neighbor without cause or use your lips to deceive. Do not say, "I will do to him as he has done to me. I will pay that man back for what he did." If your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head, and the Lord will reward you.
You may be seated. Good evening. Thinking about this for some time. We're going to get into anger tonight. We're going to talk about this series on emotional intelligence. Ooh, awesome to know. What's up, man? What's up, actually? Oh, wow, good. Let me just name some other alumni in the house. Austin, who graduated last year. Robbie Combs, who graduated here in the early 90s this year, helped us bless this chapel. This is really cool. I mean, you'll get to see like a whole lot of Al Ward from the 70s this year. I mean, this is great. We're blessed with this space. This is the kind of space we walk into. We hope it transforms our very lives and the people who come back to it because it's done just that. So for this tonight, getting into anger, we're going to get into Proverbs. And you know what Proverbs are like? They're like this kind of ancient wisdom literature, and they're like ancient tweets. This is how I think about things. There are these incredibly short sayings that have so much depth to them. And so much around wisdom around anger. And so as this series has begun around Inside Out, this is what anger looks like in Inside Out.
Did he just say he couldn't serve?
That's anger. He cares very deeply about things being fixed.
So that's how you want to fight, old man? No dessert? Oh, sure. We'll eat our dinner right after you eat this.
Don't play.
a lot of ways, it's the building blocks for sorrow, it's the building block for anger, and a lot of the things that we said last week around fear. And how you face it, you confess it, you give it to God, that it might be transformed. But a lot of this we have to do, but here, a lot to do with anger. Man, anger is way more difficult than fear. Anger is very interesting. And how Scripture understands it, and how Proverbs understands it, it's like anger hides in plain sight. And so how I want to tell you a little bit about this tonight, there's three things that I really want us to pay attention to tonight. And it's the power and paradox of anger in our time. This is going to sound odd, and a turn about face, but the gift that anger really is, and how it goes wrong, and how it might be transformed for God's use. So, I'm going to be borrowing a lot from St. Augustine tonight, from Tim Keller. They are way more eloquent on this than I am, so you can check them out a little more. But what I love about anger, actually, as you dig into it, and you face it, and look at it, is anger is one of the best examples, I think, for us to think about that emotions are not bad, but they can become bad. There's a lot of wisdom literature in antiquity and even now. I think we find emotions to be problematic. We think they're bad on their face, that they confuse us, that they mislead us. But what I suggested to you last week is that's not the case. The emotions are more like antenna. And if you take a look at them, they give you insight to your deepest values, your deepest loves, your deepest fears. They'll take you on a journey. And anger is a particular unique case here. Because like fear, it's the shadow side of love. If you discover where your anger is attached to, you will discover what you deeply love and what you will attack to keep it. I want to come back into the psalm here. I want to talk about the power of anger and how destructive it can be. Come to this proverb. This is Proverb 14:29-30. Can you throw it up to the side? Whoever is slow to anger, pay attention to this, slow to anger. We're going to come back to this again and again. Slow to anger has great understanding. The one who has a hasty temper exalts folly. Stay here for a second. Do you know why, like, if you go to bed at night and you said something really angry to somebody, you're like, man, I was such a fool. You know why? It's because you were. Yeah. And it's for good reason. Because anger will take everything with you. You haven't paid attention to it. And it makes you foolish. Go to the next one. Go to the 30. I love this one. A tranquil mind gives life to the flesh, but passion makes the bones rot. This idea that anger gets inside of you, and if you don't pay attention, it will rot you from the inside out. There's tons of research on this, right? Like, the main killer of men in America, you know what it is? Heart disease. Heart disease and heart attacks. People who have not been able to control a lot of our appetites in a lot of ways, not just food, but other appetites. And we're angry people. And it's taking our very lives. Rots us from the inside out. Here's the thing, it not only rots us from the inside out physically, it rots communities. Think about the voices that are most commonly heard in our society today. Are they not sometimes the most angry? You know a way to break up a team real quick? Let the most angry person's voice take precedence. And you have a surefire way of breaking up a team. Proverbs 15:1-18, put it this way. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Sure, Anthony. Those who are hot-tempered stir up strife, but those who are slow to anger calm contention. Slow to anger. Here's the interesting thing about anger today. It's pervasive, right? I think we all agree, like, we're coming around to an election next year, and I'm already dreading it, not for the election part, but because I know that really good people will be very angry and mean to them. They will not have the better angels of their nature take over. They will have demons come out of them with one another. They will think the worst of each other and not see the God-given nature of one another. So there's something about recognizing this anger and cutting it off at the root, right? Because roots become shoots, become trees. And so we can take a look at it and cut it off. Here's the interesting thing about anger. It's not just about that it's pervasive. I want to talk about that it actually is quite paradoxical. It is in American culture, I think people tell me. It's not only that it's pervasive, but if anyone were to ask you if you're angry, you would say probably no. Who would say no? Because good, polite people aren't angry. I don't know, we're good people. We're not angry people. And what a lot of us have been taught to do is just push it even deeper. Even deeper. And you know what anger does? It loves this. Because it gives it room to hide in plain sight. It festers and it builds on itself. And the more we deny it, the stronger it gets. Are you with me? And it becomes more corrosive. And problems are right on the money. It rots us from the inside. It hides in plain sight. It's such a paradox. It's with us all the time that we would deny it. I love what Frederick Buechner says about this. He talks about anger. He says, of the deadly sins, it's perhaps the most delightful, the one we enjoy the most. And I didn't bring it with me. Oh, there it is. Frederick Buechner writes this. He says, of the seven deadly sins, anger is possibly the most fun. To lick your wounds, to smack your lips over grievances long past, to roll your tongue over the prospect of bitter confrontations still to come. Some of you think about your roommates, I know you are. To savor to last toothsome morsel, both the pain you are given and the pain you are going to give back. In many ways, it's a feast fit for a king. The chief drawback is that what you are wolfing down is yourself. The skeleton at the feast is you. Oh man, Proverbs is right on the money. It is something that festers from the inside out. We devour, we actually quite enjoy anger. We've never let it be seen on the surface that we're quite angry. But from the inside out, we love every toothsome morsel, and we're really devouring our own soul. Anger, it's powerful. It's a paradox in our time. And I'm going to turn right on my face here and say, it's actually a gift. As we said last week, right, fear is the shadow side of love. You find out what you're afraid of, and you actually find out what you love. Anger is the same thing. You find out what you're angry at, and you find out actually what your deepest desires are, what your hopes are tied to. And here's the thing about, I think, when we think about anger, though. Most of us think there's only two ways to deal with anger, right? And this can be seen in some norms in society. One, like we said, that we think you've got to push it down. Right? Traditionalist forms of society, more conservative forms of society, like polite forms of society, you just push that anger down. You don't express it. You don't let it out. You go along and get along, right? But then there's other, like, if you look at progressive forms of society, what's a great value? You express your anger. You express your anger over injustices. You express your anger over wrongs in society. And you express your anger over things as they are. You gotta get it off your chest. This was big in the 70s, right, Al? Yeah, with me. This is making the 70s, right? Ventilate your anger. Get it out. Otherwise, it'll consume you. Then, you know, other forms of society say, push it down. What have you seen? Polite people. This is where we get civility wrong, right? Like, we think we gotta be civil people. And therefore, we just push our anger deeper and deeper down, and yet we get angrier and angrier. Bible puts it a different way. It's not have no anger. And it's not expose it and ventilate your anger all the time. No, isn't this beautiful? It's slow to anger. Isn't this interesting? Slow to anger. Just like we put up Proverbs 16:32. This is one of my favorites. Man, you can meditate on this all day long. One who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and one whose temper is controlled is mightier than one who captures a city. Isn't that powerful? One who controls or who is slow to anger is mightier than one who captures a city. A Stoic philosopher said, if you want to rule a great empire, rule over thyself. This is a beautiful translation of it within Christianity, though. It's not simply rule over your emotions, it's be attentive to them and see where they're drawn. And if you pay attention to your anger, if you attend to it and you're slow to it, you let it slow over time and not imprison you. It's like ruling over a great city. More mightier than one who captures a city. Isn't that amazing? I love that. And so there's actually this beauty about anger, this gift about anger. And you might be saying, well, that's stupid. No, anger isn't a gift. But if you think about it, right? If anger is the shadow side of love, then anger is the action that is directed to the threat of that which you want. In progressive societies, you hear people say, like, if you're not angry, you're not paying attention. There's actually something to that. It's not being quick to anger, it's slow to anger. Do you get angry about some injustices in the world? Do you get angry that people go hungry at night? Do you get angry that there's children going on dead? I mean, you gotta ask yourself, is it, if we're not angry, you gotta go, well, what's wrong with us? Well, John Chrysostom, an early Christian philosopher, put it this way. He that is angry without cause sins. But he who is not angry when there is cause sins worse. Because unreasonable patience is the cause of many vices.
Isn't that
fascinating? You've probably heard it said, right? That the opposite of love is not anger, it's not fear, it's hate. And the final form of hate is indifference. Because what is indifference? It doesn't really matter. No, just let it go. Something very wrong with us. You know, if anger doesn't well up with us for injustices in the world. One of my favorite quotes is St. Augustine. He said it this way: hope has two beautiful daughters, anger and courage. Anger at the way the world is, and courage that it doesn't have to stay that way. And Scripture says, those who are ruler of a great city are those who are slow to hope. Not no anger, not let it all out, but let it develop slowly. Be patient with it as well. As you find ways of correcting it, that's fantastic. I absolutely love it. And so, the anger will draw you into, if you pay attention to your anger, it will draw you into what you really love. Faye and Emma, our resident twins in the choir, they helped me out with this, right? They were telling me earlier today, I get advice from them all the time, because you know I'm a follower of twin boys, and I don't know what I'm doing. That, just to be perfectly honest, I have no clue what I'm doing, and they help me often. And so one of the things I'm worried about now is like, when are they gonna are they gonna ever be scared about not having their individuality? Okay, it's like, oh, I totally get that. People confuse him and me all the time. And one time we were in a play. I'm so sorry. Yeah, yes, you gave me permission. And so one time we were in a play when we were 12 years old, and we got cast as the same role. And they said, our brother was so angry. He said he was so angry, because you could see how the world looked at us. They didn't treat us like we were individuals. They didn't treat us like we had our own unique word. Who wants a brother like that? Yes? Oh, it's beautiful, right? There's some just anger. There's actually some beautiful righteous indignation sometimes when that which you love is wounded. And some of you had people you deeply love who are wounded, right? And the anger wells up within you. Something worthy about that. Anger is love directed at the threat of that which you care about. There's something worthy about it. There's something paying attention to. And it's actually worthy for this world. I mean, if you just think about Jesus, right? He's actually angry a good bit. We don't talk about this often. We think of like Jesus meek and mild, right? You sing the Christmas hymn to yourself, that baby that doesn't cry, swaddle, the swaddling clothes gets rocked back and forth. Jesus gets angry all the time. And who does he get angry at? He gets angry at leaders and powers and principalities who hurt the weak. He turns over tables in temples. He goes after people who wound others just by their might. No, there's some righteous anger in him. It's not no anger. It's not jump to anger. It's developing slowly. So if it's a gift, how does it go wrong? That's the question, right? This Sunday we have worship in here, and I was trying to talk about what sin is. Well, we often think about sin as like, and some of us have been on the bad end of getting called sinners, and that doesn't feel good. But what sin really is how Augustine put it. He calls it disordered love. Disordered love. Now, what does that mean? Disordered love is actually a good thing, just put in the wrong place. It's like good things that get lifted up until they're ultimate things. Are you with me? It's good things that we focus on and make them our total worth. And so what happens often, right, if anger is the shadow side of love, we have disordered loves. And therefore, we have disordered anger. And it spews out beyond us. We push it down. What happens when someone actually makes you angry? I love this, right? And someone actually makes me angry? I'm like, no, I'm not angry. No, I'm not angry. No. And what am I actually doing there? One, I'm denying that I'm angry. And two, I'm saying I'm better than one. I'm saying you can't make me angry. And what is that actually doing? Because to say if I were angry, all I mean, this is important. If I were to say I was angry, that'd be some vulnerability. And if I were to do that, then I might offer the opportunity for vulnerability in return. And we just can't afford to be weak, can we? We just can't afford to show weakness. We're actually going to be more likely to express our fear than we are anger. Because we fear we might be convicted. Some of us. And it just festers even more. It doubles down on itself. It catapults itself out into the world.
It builds on itself. It grows and we have disordered anger. If I want to think about just a little bit more, and this is how it goes wrong. And I think a lot of us over time live with a kind of low-grade anger all the time. And the problem is it takes over. If we don't face it, is that anger will shred and blaze everything. If you're angry with a particular thing about somebody, you won't see the particular thing. You will just see them. And you will use your anger completely on them. But if you're slow to anger, you'll be precise enough. Follow me, this is really important. This is actually where love the sinner, hate the sin is really important. Because you can see the whole of the person and be precise about the thing you're angry with. But if you're not slow to anger, you will destroy that other person. And you will cut and blaze over top of them. And a lot of us live with kind of low-grade anger all the time, but life and even God. Because a lot of us feel like we haven't gotten our comeuppance. We haven't gotten what we feel like we deserve. We haven't gotten what we think is ours. And so the thing with anger, just like fear, is that you gotta recognize it. You gotta confess it. You gotta face it. You gotta cut it at the root. I love that phrase. Roots become shoots, become trees, right? And you can love within you, and you can't let it do that, because we're better than that. I wanna finish on this one. This is Proverbs 25. 21 to 26. And this is the prescription from Scripture often. If your enemy is hungry, give him food to eat. If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head, and the Lord will reward you. Some of us look at that, and I think we say, that is not practical. That is not real. No one is giving their enemies food to drink. Food to drink, or water to drink. No, that's not practical. Why is this often the prescription of Scripture? I mean, this is more than any kind of wisdom saying. This is like self-sacrificial almost, right? I don't suggest weakness, and some of us will say this isn't practical, except that it is. And I've seen one of you do it before. One of my first years here, I was meeting a large gathering of students, and this was a leader of a lot of students who was in front of them, and they were tearing them down. They were not being precise with their critique. They were cutting and blazing. And I could see like him getting a little angry at some point. And then all of a sudden he sat back in his seat and he started nodding at them. He said, I can see your point there. And it was miserable. It was amazing. And at the end of the while they were done yelling at him, he said, thanks, we're going to take these into consideration and we'll do better next time. And I came up and after him, amazing. He said, you couldn't see my hands, but they were clenched like my fists under the table. And he said, and after a while, I started hearing some things that were actually true. And I had to listen to those things. And some of the things weren't true, but what I tried to do was listen to what was below the anger. Right? Because anger that builds on itself isn't typically about the thing that you, it's about something deeper. And when you go back to your room tonight and your roommate gets mad at you about something, it may not be about that. It might be that they're lonely. It might be that they're homesick. It might be that there's something more going on underneath, and you got to read between the lines. And he He said this afterwards. He said, my job, and he said, being in front of that room, is to serve this particular group of students. And if I'm not doing that, I don't know what I'm doing. It was absolutely amazing. He absorbed all their anger. And was precise in what he saw. Slow to anger. It's far more practical than language. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. It's a kind of discipleship that takes practice. And you can get better at it the more you do it. Come with me to the scripture, right? This is it. This is the final part for tonight. Think about what God is for us. Think about how the upper scripture goes and it lands on Jesus. You know how we have this kind of low-grade anger? It's because when God became killable, we killed him. When God became vulnerable, we wounded him. And we put him on a cross, and he absorbed all our anger and looked at us with precision and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Absorbed all our hate and anger and vengeance and wounds and returned with kind of precision. Absolutely amazing. One of my favorite quotes is by Dr. King. A student one time, he was speaking to a group of students up in Chicago, I believe, and one of them was taking issue with his nonviolent movement. And he said, you know why we're going to stay nonviolent? He was talking mostly about the white students. He said, you know why we're going to be nonviolent? Because in the end, we'll have a double victory. We will match your physical force with soul force. And we will not only win our freedom, we will win your freedom and return. He's talking about a release from anger that we don't want to face. It's at the depth of a lot of us. And we don't want to admit it's there. But once we do, man, and once we see the kind of God that God is in Jesus, man, it can be shaken. And you can come like that. Join me. Gracious God, we ask for more courage than we think we have to face our fears, to face our own anger. Though we may think we're very polite people, that we're very nice people, we ask to come face to face with low-grade anger that's underneath it all. And those times we've exploded, and those times we've pushed it down. It takes to a place of confession where we can put it before you and you can transform it. You can lead us into lives that are slow to anger, to have some righteous anger for the way the world is, that we can be your hands and feet and serve in this world. But also people who can reflect your mercy out. Be the people who you're called to be. It's in Christ's name.
Amen. What an awesome God that we serve, y'all. So let's stand and worship him and just glorify his name.
as well this week.